سلام، مهمان این گفتگو زاهد نصرالله خان سفیر پاکستان در افغانستان است که در آخرین روزهای ماموریتش در کابل بسر می‌برد. با او درباره نقش پاکستان در آوردن طالبان به میز گفتگوها و آینده روند صلح و نیز سیاست‌های منطقه‌ای پاکستان گفتگو خواهیم کرد. Ambassador, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
Ambassador, Pakistan continued to serve as a safe haven for terrorist organizations that originally focused, says the recent report of the U.S. Department of State. Why Pakistan doesn't eliminate these sanctuaries?
Thank you very much, first of all, for having me on the program. I think similar allegations have also been made against Afghanistan in this report as well. So these reports have their own political agenda, and Pakistan has done unparalleled actions to fight against terrorism, and we have been one of the most effective victims of terrorism as well.
What's the political agenda of this report?
It has different agenda. I do not wish to discuss it here, but it can have different agendas. But I just want to tell you that Pakistan has made unparalleled sacrifices, and this has been acknowledged by the international community worldwide. So I'm amazed at this report.
The report also says that Pakistan allowed terrorist groups or other groups fighting in Afghanistan and India to operate from its soil, like Afghan Taliban, Haqqani Network, Lashkar-e-Taiba, and JEM.
Yes. Well, first of all, let us talk about Afghanistan. Afghanistan, as you know, that I have read this report, and the country report on Afghanistan says that the groups like TTP are given safe haven in Afghanistan against Pakistan. But forget the report and let's talk on the real situation on ground. The real situation on ground is that we have been making, you know, the fencing on the border for this very purpose, not to stop the Afghan people, but to secure both Afghanistan and Pakistan from the threat, common threat of terrorism. We have the APEPS document, in which both countries have
but that has pledged. Not been implemented.
Let me yes tell you that it is there. The implementation has to be from both sides. It is has to be mutual. So the meetings have to go on to find the mutual mechanisms. When we were conducting counter-terrorism operations in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, and we requested Afghanistan to provide the anvil. So we are willing to cooperate with Afghanistan. We have made several offers to them, also to help them make a border post at places which Afghanistan does not have capacity to do so, and provide them with logistical support, as well as to open ground coordination centers at Chaman and Torkham, with the reciprocal ground coordination centers by Afghanistan army on their side. So all those proposals are under discussion between the two countries. And this is a common thread. And we have to understand that the deep integration of our two countries with regard to both trade, with regard to our people-to-people exchanges, is such that these issues have to be resolved in a mutual environment of cooperation.
You mentioned TTP in context of the recent report. Who are TTP? Yes. What they are doing?
They are supposed to be. According to the report, it says that they are in the ungoverned areas.
According to the Pakistan's policy and Pakistan's stance, who is TTP?
TTP is a proscribed group in Pakistan. It is there on our Ministry of Interior's website. Pakistan government took very severe action against them, and they are said to be here in safe havens here in Afghanistan.
We are in Afghanistan.
I have no idea about that. I cannot say. I have no evidence to that effect. But that is when you are mentioning the report. So I'm talking in context of that report.
Yes, the report also said that some terrorists like Masood Azhar and Hafez Saeed are residing in Pakistan under the state protection despite the government denial.
No, there is no evidence to such. We have taken action against all, and the court has also recently ruled against this Hafiz, against him as well. So there is no tolerance for any type of terrorism in any its forms and manifestations in Pakistan, even for extremism. There is no tolerance.
What has been done against Hafiz Saeed and Masood Azhar?
Hafiz Saeed, I think the court recently ruled against him, and I do not know the exact.
He has not been sentenced.
Yeah,
he is free, according to reports from Pakistani media also.
No, he is under custody, and I think the case is ongoing.
About the Afghan Taliban, where is Hibatullah Akhundzada, leader of the Taliban?
How should I know? You tell me if you know.
Is he leading the Quetta Shura nowadays?
No, these are again, unfortunately, allegations and baseless allegations to, unfortunately, shift responsibility for the situation in Afghanistan.
That's not shifting the accusations. That's a fact that we are the leader of the Taliban, the group that's fighting in Afghanistan.
Well, that is your view. You are right. You are entitled to hold your view, but that there is no fact in that at all.
Where is Quetta Shura?
But there is no Quetta Shura. I mean, people keep talking about it, and I mean, it's up to you.
But why you we don't call it Kabul Shura or Kandahar Shura or Mazar Shura?
It's such imaginations, you know.
Pardon me?
I mean, we can't help you if you indulge in such imagination. We can't help you with that.
Okay, about the Taliban, when they will stop fighting in Afghanistan? Do you have any idea?
No, this is an ongoing conflict, and from the last 2001, and Pakistan with the international community is working selflessly to have the intra-Afghan negotiations begin and to have the impediments removed in the start of IEN. And hopefully when the Afghans will sit together in the IEN, then they will, as per the US Taliban agreement, it says that they will sit down and discuss the modalities of a comprehensive ceasefire. So it is up to the Afghans.
Do you know when that will happen?
Well, we are all hoping that it happens sooner than later, and we are slowly moving towards that with the conditionality of the release of prisoners. So we are all anxiously waiting that it happens sooner than later, and peace returns to the people of Afghanistan. Nobody deserves peace more than the people of Afghanistan.
Ambassador, tell us how Pakistan brought the Taliban to the negotiations table with the US.
No, we don't have the influence to bring anyone to the negotiation table with the U.S. The U.S. were in contact with them in Doha, and they were holding these talks. We, like other countries, with our limited influence, also played a role, both or not only with Taliban, but also with the Afghan government, to persuade them, to convince them that this is the way forward to make a breakthrough in the ongoing stalemate, which was there, the military stalemate, and that the only solution to the problem was a political solution and not a military solution.
By denying the Pakistan's influence on the Taliban, you want to say that Pakistan hasn't played a significant role in the peace process of Afghanistan?
No, that is up to you to say what is significant and what is insignificant. What I'm saying is that I don't think that either Pakistan or any other country or any other group can dictate things to Taliban or to either to the Afghan government. That's what I'm saying.
What made the Pakistan to appoint a special envoy for Afghanistan? Does it mean that Pakistan wants to engage more diplomatically in the peace process?
No, if you read his title, it says Afghanistan Affairs. And yes, we would like to engage. There was perhaps a need also felt to remain engaged, because the Afghan intra-Afghan negotiations will be an important part. So there should be a special envoy for the peace process, and as well as for advancing, the relations between our two brotherly countries.
Does the merging of Fatah with Khyber Pakhtunkhwa have anything to do with Pakistan helping with the Afghan peace process?
Could you please repeat that question? I didn't get it.
Pakistan merged Fatah region, federally administrated regions, to Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Does it have anything with the peace process?
No. It has absolutely nothing. This is to do with the internal constitutional and development and social issues of the country. There was a long-standing demand of the people that they felt that since a long time they have not been merged, so they were not getting all the benefits, the development and political and social benefits which people in other parts of the country were enjoying. So there was a sort of a dichotomy between Pakistan and Fatah. So that dichotomy the government has eventually ended. So nothing to do with the peace process.
But the people who are part of PTM, Pashtun Tahaffuz Movement, people from Fatah, are protesting for their rights from the Pakistani government, but they are being cracked down on. How Pakistan wants to make development in Fatah if it doesn't hear the sound of the people there?
Look, Pakistan is a democratic country, and there are different voices and different opinions, and people have the right to voice their difference of opinion if they don't agree with the policy of the government. And those are people from different walks of life do. But they do not have the right to take the law and order in their own hands. So the people from any region of Pakistan have this fundamental right. And the people of Fatah, in majority, they are very happy with what has happened. And there is development now, significant and on ground and visible development in Fatah, which is going on.
Has PTM done anything illegal in Pakistan?
It is not a matter of have they done anything illegal, but if some political group does engage in violence, or if it does engage at that time the violation of certain rules, then there is action against such a group or such people, That is what it is.
Is there any evidence that PTM has conducted violence or protested violently?
I think there were some incidents. I don't remember them clearly, but I think there were some incidents and of violence.
About India-Afghanistan relations, how sensitive is this relation for Islamabad?
Look, we are very clear. I think this is a much overplayed let's say, notion in Afghanistan. Pakistan wants relationship with Afghanistan on basis of equal footing, mutual respect, and mutual trust. Afghanistan is a sovereign country. It can have relations, any type of relations, with any country that it so wishes to.
Including India.
Of course, it is up to the Afghans. Why should we have any objections to that? Of course, including India, if Afghanistan has relations or Pakistan has relations with any country, which are then clearly saying that okay, we are making this relationship to do something against Pakistan, then of course we would have objection. But otherwise, why would we have objection if Afghanistan has relations with any country, including India? We have absolutely no objections. Why should we?
So,
Afghanistan is a sovereign country, let me say this. And we sincerely respect Afghanistan's sovereignty. And we hope that the same respect is given to Pakistan in every context.
If you say you are not opposed to Afghanistan having relations with India, you mean that you don't have concerns about these relations?
We don't have what? Can you kindly repeat?
Concern.
Okay. No, of course not. Why should we have concern?
Do you know how many consulates does India have in Afghanistan?
I think perhaps four, but I heard maybe they have closed some, but maybe perhaps four.
There are four consulates in Herat, Kandahar, Mazar-Sharif, and
okay,
Jalalabad. Do you know any other
no
diplomatic
objection.
Office of India in Afghanistan?
Let me say India can have 34 consulates in 34 provinces.
And you don't oppose to that?
Absolutely. How could we? You are a sovereign country. It's up to you.
About ISIS-K that has conducted attacks in both Afghanistan and Pakistan, how big is part of Haqqani network in ISIS-K?
Well, I don't know. I don't have any information in it. You know, these are issues with intelligence matters. One only reads things in the newspapers and in reports, but. I can't say anything with any.
Do you think if Taliban and the Afghan government come to an agreement, the ISIS or Daesh will continue fighting and violence in Afghanistan?
I think that President Ghani has expressed this concern at his inaugural address as well. And it could very much do continue because, of course, as we all know, that ISIS and Daesh have their own agendas.
What do you think should be done to fight ISIS in the region?
I think there should be a mutual cooperation between all the countries to face this common threat.
What's the Pakistan's policy regarding recent escalation in India-China border?
Pakistan is watching it with concern. Pakistan is a country which believes is a peace-loving country. And we believe that all issues in the region should be resolved peacefully.
About Kashmir, why Pakistan opposes the revocation of special status of Jammu and Kashmir by India?
Yes. Security Council, ruled in 1948 that Kashmir is a disputed territory between Pakistan and India, and this will be resolved through an impartial, transparent, and fair plebiscite under the auspices of the UN to decide the status of the Kashmir. And it also said that any move to change that status, even through the State Assembly of Kashmir, is null and void. And in those Security Council resolutions remain pending, and Kashmir remains pending an unfinished agenda on this agenda of the Security Council. And until and unless the resolutions of the Security UN Security Council are not implemented, they remain valid. And India has done that violation by carrying out and trying to, through this 370A on 5th August, to annex Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. That is what our primarily and in a nutshell our objection to it.
What do you think should be done with Kashmir? Do you support the independence movement of Kashmir?
First of all, as you know, unfortunately, while the world is in a lockdown due to virus, COVID-19, but Kashmir is unfortunately under oppressive lockdown of the Indian army and the Indian security forces numbering more than 800,000. First of all, that oppression in Kashmir, in particular in the valley, must come to an end. Secondly, India should allow international observers, both the United Nations human rights people, as well as the OIC observers, as well as Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, and others, to give them free access to come and see for themselves what is happening there, as well as those countries who want to send those observers. That relief must come to the people of Kashmir, and the gross human rights violations which are documented in a trove of documents by established and impartial international human rights organization.
How Pakistan supports anti-India movements in Kashmir?
No, there is no anti-India movement there in Kashmir. It is not a matter of anti-India movement. It is the matter of the Kashmiri people who are making a movement, who are making a struggle for their right to self-determination, which has been promised to them by the United Nations Security Council resolutions. It is the oppression against which they are protesting. It is, their sons, their mothers, their sisters, they have been martyred, their lands have been burned, their houses have been burned down, and it is undescribable, human rights violations which have taken place.
What about China? The reports say that nearly 2 million Muslims have been put in concentration camps and are forcefully converted from their religion. What's the stance of Pakistan?
China is a long-standing friend of Pakistan. And if there is any such issue, that should be addressed by the world bodies. So I believe that there is no evidence to it. And that issue, you can't compare apples and oranges. The Kashmir is a unique issue. Like I've said, it is in the Security Council's resolutions. So you can't say that, this issue has, there is some other issue. So what about this issue if you're talking about Kashmir?
No, sir. We are asking that what is the stance of Pakistan and Islamic Republic in the world regarding the enforced jailing of 2 million Muslims in a neighboring country?
Like I've said, China is a great friend. Pakistan, China, we both countries respect international human rights. And if there is an issue, then the respective human rights bodies should approach China.
Several organizations working for human rights, including Human Rights Council of the United Nations and also HRW and other human rights organizations, have voiced concerns about the treating of Muslims in China, in Xinjiang province. But like you said, China is Pakistan's best friend, and you don't want to say anything against that. But if we come back to Afghanistan, what kind of a government you want for the post-peace deal Afghanistan?
I really feel like laughing here. Again, I've said, you look, how can we convince you that we sincerely respect sovereignty of the one people? We, you know, our histories are linked. We take pride in the Afghan leaders who came and conquered India. There is
but
no
I mean, what kind of a government you think is better for Afghanistan?
It is for the Afghan people to decide. You know, that is the issue. Why should anyone from any country of the world tell the Afghan people that this type of government is good for you? The Afghan people are very intelligent. They are very resourceful people, and they are very proud people. How can anyone tell them what to do with regard to the way they want to live, the way they want to be governed? It is for the Afghan people to decide, and that is the issue.
Do you support
the Afghan people in majority? They are happy with one system. They agree with one system. I think the entire world will endorse it, including Pakistan.
Thank you. Do you support the Taliban to follow their harsh social and religious policies in Afghanistan again if they come to power?
No, we don't support any such thing. Why should we support it, Taliban, for any such system? Have you not seen the system? Have you ever visited Pakistan?
Yes, I have visited Pakistan during the 2018 elections.
Yes. So you know what type of system we have. So how can we support systems which we ourselves, which we have? We have a very mashallah, a moderate and liberal democracy, and we follow Islam, we love our religion.
And so you think securing the achievements of the last 20 years in Afghanistan is important for our future?
Yes, I think, why not? Afghanistan has made tremendous developments in all the fields, and no
including
country...
Including the women's rights and media freedom?
Certainly, why not? We respect that. We are still working for that. Women empowerment and media freedom is the pillars of the society in our country, and we support that in any other country. Why not?
And you urge the Taliban to respect these values if they come to power again?
It is up to it. I'm again saying it is up to the Afghan people. Why should we tell anyone, either the Taliban or the Afghan government? It is up to you people to decide.
As my last question, Ambassador, do you see any other way for the Taliban to join or come to power except through the election? From Pakistan's view.
Look, we should not go ahead and I think speculate on any of these issues. The intra-Afghan negotiations, I believe, are going to show us the way. If all these issues would be discussed there, and then the Afghan people will give their consent to what has been agreed there, and then that would be endorsed by the entire world. All the countries of the world who have been involved with Afghanistan and who want to see an end to this conflict and want to see an enduring peace and prosperity here, which is most important as a country for Pakistan.
So you are not sure that the Taliban will accept a democratic election in Afghanistan?
It's not a matter of being sure. I'm saying that these are all issues which will be discussed there. I cannot speak on behalf of any group in Afghanistan, including that of Taliban.
Zahed Nasrullah Khan, outgoing ambassador of Pakistan to Afghanistan, thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. And before I leave, I like to just make a very small message to my Afghan brothers and sisters, and to tell them that the people of Pakistan love you and respect you, and this is the basis on which we want to have an enduring relationship with our Afghan brothers and sisters and our neighbor. Thank you.
Thank you.